If you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. If you know yourself, but not the enemy, for every victory gained, you will also suffer a defeat. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to Paragon Academy Live. This is our wizard stream. If you've been to these before, to Phoenix League Live, we have rebranded. This is the first live stream we have done since the launch of the Paragon Academy. So I'm really happy that we're back to doing these. And since we now have a giant reservoir of Paragons to pull from, getting the guests for this is a lot easier. So today, bam, we have four great guests with us, all from the Paragon Academy. You guys can unmute yourselves. We have, I'm Wunjo, by the way. Hello, I'm down here in the middle. I'll be your host. Above me and to my left, we have Paragon Wizo from Desert Winds. Is that correct?
Currently around there.
Above me to my right, currently with no video, he's going to be phoning in. We have Paragon Tenebrus from Northern Lights, not Northern Lights. Where are you guys?
From Rivermore.
Yes, that's it. Down to my left, we have, and down to my left and right, actually, we have two students from the academy that they are trying to show off their stuff today and further their progress towards Paragonhood. To my left, we have Berrian Charmcaster. Give a wave. And to my right, we have Tenebrus's apprentice and a journeyman in the academy. We have Lauxus. Say hi. All right, so for some reason, I think I have your kingdoms messed up on my cards. I'll fix that as we go. Anyway, the way we're going to be doing stuff today is each of our four guests will be doing a 15-minute or up to 15-minute lecture for you guys on the topic of their choosing. It's important to know that everything they're going to be saying is their own opinions, and nothing that we're saying should be taken as 100% fact. It's important when you're just playing Ampguard in general to experiment and to want to do things and to explore as much as you can about the classes you're playing. So what we're presenting you today is stories from experience and advice based on things that have worked. All right, there's definitely other ways to go about these things, but here are our four different things that have been working for these four speakers today. We will be having the Q&A at the end of this stream, so you can ask questions and I'll try to make notes of them, but we will not be directly answering any of them until the end of the stream. With that said, I think we're about ready to get into our first speaker. Now I feel really bad because I think I have his kingdom wrong. we'll fix that while he's talking. From Rivermore, he is the apprentice of our Paragon speaker, Tenebrus. He is a journeyman in the academy, which is a teacher assistant, so he's been helping a lot of our wizard students with their trials. And he's going to be talking to us about Elemental Barrage and Evoker. So please give your attention to Lauxus.
How's it going, guys? First off, I want to say thanks to the Paragon Academy for giving me this opportunity to speak and hopefully speak to newer wizards who haven't gotten to sixth level yet and talk to them a little bit about Elemental Barrage and Evoker. But anytime I start stuttering, I'm sorry. I have a stutter problem. That's why I don't play Battle Mage. Just say. All right. So over the past 2 years, I've been playing Ampguard. I have solely played Warrior and Wizard. From what I've learned from Wizard, though, is that Elemental Barrage and Evoker is one of the most powerful combinations of archetypes that you can have as a wizard. The utility that it offers to you is extremely vast. You can change a battlefield completely within a couple seconds of being on the field, if you know what you're doing. I can speak that from general experience, playing at a duchy. When I put on my Elemental Barrage, people don't even want to be near me. First things that I would like to talk about is, why is Elemental Barrage so powerful, as opposed to Battle Mage or Warlock? Battle Mage has a few flaws to it. Monks. Easiest flaw you can come to. Besides the heat weapon of the pole, you give Monk Flame Blade or anything like that, you're basically useless against them. Immunities, those definitely limit what you can do, especially as a verbal caster. With Warlock, your verbals are basically destroyed. I mean, you only take Flame and Death, your utility is completely gone. Yes, you get a ton of Flame and Death, and you can take other spell walls, but I just don't feel like you're going to get the most out of wrecking a field with that build. Maybe good for one-on-one, but not one versus many. All right. So, I believe that Elemental Barrage has the answer for any opponent. It absolutely does. Every spell ball at your disposal, if used correctly, can dispatch any enemy, including any enemy that has enchantments that makes them feel immortal. Pro Mag, not a problem. I have an answer for it. It's this little gray ball. That's the answer. Monk Magic Ball Block. Little gray ball. It's the answer. Ancestral Armor. The black ball. The gray ball. Phase Bolts and Spears. If you have any idea what I'm talking about. So, let's talk about exactly what Elemental Barrage is. Elemental Barrage is a incant that you would say, I'm filled with the power of magic. And basically what it does is the caster may use any magic balls they are currently carrying by stating the name of the magic ball immediately prior to throwing the ball in place of the incantation. It also ends when you pick up any balls or you cast any magic. So you have to stay in the Elemental Barrage for it to continue being active. Basically what that means is I don't have to say the incant for the spell ball before I throw it. I'm just going to say the name of the ball and I'm going to throw it. Fastest way you can do it. Makes it way overpowered. Evoker allows you to actually limits you. You can only take verbals at a range of touch or self. But Elemental Barrage becomes charge times 10. Now, in every single one of my lists, I always put Steel Life Essence. And this is very true to this list, having Steel Life Essence, because you can instantly charge Elemental Barrage with it right after you're out of them. Use your last kill, that you can get, use SLE, charge it, go back and do it, pick up your magic balls, and then go do it again. I've seen that work plenty of times on any field that I've ever touched. If you play it correctly, it is extremely overpowered. A lot of you might not have seen been able to play with all the spell balls yet. So I just want to kind of go through all the spell balls that you can actually use as in your Elemental Barrage kit. We're going to start off with Force Bolts. They're a good basic overall ball. I mean, it's a sorcery school, so nobody's immune to it naturally. It's weapon destroying, armor destroying. Sorry, not armor destroying, armor breaking. And it deals a wound if you get hit. So it works generally all over the place. It's your good little sidearm that you can go to at any time. Then we go into the subdual balls for Entangle Ball. 60-second stop. If it's not a Barbar, and I don't really see a lot of people get immunity to subdual very often, the Entangle Ball is a really good way to stop an enemy in its tracks from charging you down or charging one of your friends down. I mean, it's a really good way for crowd control. Same thing with the Ice Ball. Frozen for 60 seconds. It's also engulfing. Engulfing is like the best thing ever. So Ice Ball is really good because at that point, you can't hurt anybody. No, you cannot hurt a single player on the team unless you are released or I have another buddy come over here and shatter you. Now we're, I'm going to start talking about the bread and butter balls for any wizard. Lightning bolt, flame school, barbars, get out of here. This one's going to stop you. It's engulfing, stop 60, weapon destroying, armor breaking with a wound. I mean, basically, I'm taking right there. I'm taking a force bolt and adding a stopped effect to it. This is a really good middle tier ball that you can use. Works great with drag below, but you can't use drag below with elemental barrage. So it's basically stop and wound. Fireball, my favorite one. It's weapon destroying, shield destroying, armor destroying, and wound skill. I can't say any more about it. I mean, wound skill automatically wins. If I can hit you in a place that's not armored, you're dead. I don't care. I have a really good arm, and I will hit somebody from 30 yards out running. And Tenebrus has seen it plenty of times. It's my favorite ball to go to. Phase Bolt. Phase Bolt is a very interesting ball. And because it's interesting, I'm actually going to read it straight from the rulebook for you guys. All right, Phase Bolt. This magic ball does not interact with other ongoing magic or abilities. Example, this magic ball is not stopped by stone skin, projection from magic, and does not trigger the effects of Troll's Blood, Undead Minion, Magic Ball Block, or similar magic or abilities. This is the wizard's get-out-of-jail-free card. Absolutely, with the Elemental Barrage. When you use the Phase Bolt, you're basically saying, I know you have all this wonderful stuff, but I'm going to do it anyway. And a lot of people aren't going to like that. Monks don't like that. I mean, I'm going to break a bolt. I'm going to kill you with it. I'm going to make you have to worry about dodging my spell ball, because even if it hits you, you're going to have something happen to you. Phase bolt is weapon hit is destroyed. Sorry, monks. Armor hit with points remaining is subject to armor breaking. That's not too bad either. It also gives a wound. Phase Bolt, though, does not supersede the frozen existential or out-of-game status. It just doesn't. That would be just too broken to do that. And then we go into Sphere. Sphere Annihilation, basically, if it touches you, you're dead. I don't care if you have Ancestral Armor on, you're dead. You got to use that correctly, though. I mean, don't just waste it. Use it on, like, your six-point warrior that's running around in flow. Hit him in the back with it. He's instantly dead. If he's running Ancestral Armor, he's dead. If he's somebody that's got a big shield that's really having a hard time, like an imbue shield, and other wizards are having, druids are having a hard time with him, use it. Use the Sphere of Annihilation. It goes through the, I missed that one up for a second. It goes through Imbue Shield. That would be a good thing to use at that point as well. All of those magic balls, I know I didn't talk about Suppression Bolt. It doesn't get used very often from what I've seen. Suppression Bolt, you're suppressed for 60 seconds. I mean, unless you're going to play a midline Elemental Barrage, which I'll get into later, is different levels of Elemental Barrage that you can play on a field. Midline, I mean, I wouldn't take it, but that's just me. So, a big thing to Elemental Barrage for getting us good at what we do is you need to be able to think fast on your feet. You need to be able to remember who's got what enchantments, who has these immunities, and you need to be able to choose the right ball at the right time for that. I've been on a field, on a playing Phoenix ball actually, and one day I looked at my field, and halfway through the game I dumped half my spell balls out of my bag and just picked up the ones that I wanted, used Elemental Barrage on those because I knew those ones were affected, then the rest of them that I took weren't going to be there, and it was just extra weight. Especially when you're trying to score in that volatile state. I don't want to get hit on the bags. Those are very important things for an Elemental Barrage Wizard. I also feel that there are three ways to play this archetype. You can play a backline Elemental Barrage. Excuse me. Use a lot of crowd control. So ice balls, entangles, lightning bolts, suppression bolts if you need them. But that's basically what you're trying to do. You're trying to stop somebody from progressing into your base or scoring a goal. Midline. So you're going to play in the middle. Think about it as any sport. You're the middle defender. You can attack and defend at the same time. Those are when you want to see your phase bolts, your a lot of your lightning bolts coming out, stopping players before they can get into your territory, or just killing them outright. And then you have frontline. And I've talked to Tenebris about this before, my Paragon, and he never runs a frontline Elemental Barrage. But I seem to do really well with it. This requires you to be able to think extremely quickly on your feet. Take a short sword, take the balls, and put them in a bag, and just go to town, front lines, right up there with the warriors, right up there with the barbarians, and just knowing which ball to grab and which ball to throw at the right time to hit your target to get the best effect out of it is something that takes time and field practice to do. If I see a white sash, I automatically think, don't even worry about this side of my kit. I have to go to this side of my kit, and probably in the back side of my kit. Just to get a general, like, my lightning bolts, they sit on my back hip, my back left hip. And I know that if I see a barbarian, I have to go right to the lightning bolt. It stops them. They can't take enchantments, so it's the perfect thing to keep them away from me. Let somebody else get the kill at that point. Fireballs. Like, those are on my front left hip. And those are the ones that I use the most. Those are my favorite ones, so... knowing your kit with Elemental Barrage is a very important thing. So when we each one of those works in a that threw me off actually. Oh man. Alright. So I covered that. Elemental Barrage is by far, if you have any sort of an arm, if you've ever played baseball, if you've ever played football, anything that involves throwing a ball, you're going to do better at Elemental Barrage outright. It's just you start off a little bit better. I played football and I played baseball. I was a pitcher and I played in the college baseball, and that's where a lot of it just comes easier to me to throw a spell ball fast and accurately. And anybody that works at it can do it as well. Moving targets here and there. There's a couple trials in the wizard sections that you can do that as well. But I would suggest to anybody trying to play Elemental Barrage to its fullest to basically make sure you can hit your targets and you can think quickly. Those are the two things. I call that frontline a gunslinger because I know I'm going to die. But I'm going to take as many people with me as I can, and I can reliably, with that up, take four or five people with me and not even have to worry about it. And I think that if you guys practice at it, you can do it too. At the end of the stream, I'm sure that they're going to have the question and answer segment, and I'll be more than happy to answer any questions. And I thank you guys for letting me talk to you. Sorry, I lost my train of thought there for a second. Yeah, I just thank you very much.
And there we have it. Everyone, give a digital round of applause for Lauxus. Wow, I'm getting an echo. Where are we getting that echo from? Hello?
Hello?
Oh, I'm hearing some sort of echo. Can everybody hear me okay? All right, it seems like it's gone away. So, next up on our docket, we're going to keep moving straight along. If you have any questions for Lauxus, write them down or post them in chat, and I'll make a note, and we will ask them during the Q&A. So, up next, we have Berrian Charmcaster from Rising Winds. Now, Berrian is, of all the wizards here, is the, I'm not going to say least experienced, but he is the one who is... has the most that he wants to prove today, so we hope he's put together something really great for you today. He's going to be talking about the idea of Wizard as a support class. So, without further ado, I give you Aspiring Paragon Berrian Charmcaster. Take it away.
Hey guys, so thank you for joining all of us today. It's nice to actually be able to be out there. I'm here to explain playing a wizard in a supportive role. The points I'll be going over today will be first and foremost how a support wizard even works. I know when most people think support class, they think druid, healer, bard. Of course, those are your main support classes in Ampguard. But wizard does have a form of support that a lot of people like to overlook, and I'll be getting into that here in a little bit. Second, I'll be going over what spells work best when building a support wizard set. And last, I'll cover some situational aspects, as in, what would be the best thing to use against this situation going on at the time. I hope this helps. Maybe for those of you who like wizards so much and also like the support, this will help tie in so you can make it a little bit better. Now, a support wizard works differently from most other styles of caster classes. Support wizards rely more on crowd control. Yes, wizards have enchantments, and a couple stupid powerful ones at that, actually. But a wizard is much more powerful as using spells to control the enemy team. That's where the crowd control is, and that's why it's called support. You don't, buff the entire team like a druid does. You don't buff the entire team like the druid does. You don't keep people alive and throwing them out there like healers. But it is very efficient, and like Lauxus said with his Elemental Barrage, Ice Ball, Entangle, beautiful support keeping the team hindered. Now, something to think about whenever you think of crowd control is, how is it supporting? Well, what if that barbarian keeps bullying the team? Freeze him. He can't do anything. He's nullified. Sure, killing him outright does seem like a better idea, but depending on the life count, the crowd control would be a lot more effective than just outright killing him. Warrior, get rid of equipment. What is the warrior's biggest friend? Equipment. Assassins going against the Sentry all the time? Pull him out of it. He can't use it again for a good 30 seconds. He's done. Alright. A fun thing about crowd control is it aggravates people. And personally, I find entertainment out of seeing somebody get aggravated just because I'm doing a good job. Let's see here. Now, if I'm running a crowd control build, I do like to get a little bit of help from other people around me. One of my favorite things is Gift of Air from a druid. I don't use sword or dagger, so Gift of Air is completely useful for that situation. Alright, now, let's go into buffing your allies. Wizards do have enchantments. They have 4 exactly. And the enchantments, pretty much all of them are good on just about anybody. Just about. Protection from magic is your umbrella. Everyone can use it, basically. But it's also, in my opinion, a very situational thing. It may not be useful at all. Let's see here. The other enchantments. Some of the other spells, I'll go back on the enchantments here in a little bit, I guess. Some of the other spells that are good for support is Word of Mending, Greater Mend, Release, and Mend. Now, Word of Mending or Greater Mend is useful if you don't use a lot of enchantments for your Maybe useful if you have somebody with a lot of armor on your team. Otherwise, it may not necessarily be the best thing. Release and Mend are much, much more useful than Greater Mend or Word of Mending for the fact of somebody else is always going to be doing some kind of state thing throughout the game, and Release just knocks that out. And Mend, oh look, your sword's broken, Here, let me have it. It's good. Go. Very much more useful than the other two. Now, hindering opponents, there's a lot more for that one. Let's go over some of the more useful ones. Pyrotechnics, heat weapon, lightning bolt, fireball, yes, I did say fireball, ice ball, hold person, break concentration, shove, and dispel magic. Yes, like I said, I did say fireball, and here's one of the reasons why. Because fireball can just knock out a shield. Warrior or barbarian getting really annoying with that shield all the way, all up in your face, blocking everything, fireball. The only exception would be if they have imbue shield, and like Laxus said, you can throw a sphere of annihilation, but you probably won't have that. There are other good techniques. I mean, if nothing else, lightning bolt. Stop them. Don't let them move. Hold person is a very good quick verbal to inflict the stop state, which means they can't move. They're stuck in this one place. They're kind of stranded. Pyrotechnics, it is wordy, but it is useful because it wipes out every single equipment that they are carrying on them at the time. Armor, shields, weapons, all of it's gone. Heat weapon is a good alternative if you are versing someone who only has, like, one pole arm or something, monks primarily, because, boom, pole arm's gone. Unless they have, like, flame blade. Then that's where your dispel magic comes useful. Break concentration is very good for the quick stops. Like, you see the healer back there healing somebody up. Break concentration. He can't do anything for another 10 seconds. You just stop that heal. You delayed time. Granted, I would, of course, a lot of people would just rather kill him while he's healing. But delaying until that kill definitely makes a benefit. And then, of course, dispel magic, knockout enchantments. Wizards have it on a charge times 3, so it makes it even better for them. And shove is just a good get out of my face. Some of the other hinder spells are Icy Blast, Suppression Aura, Destroy Armor, Shatter Weapon, Throw, Entangle, Ravage, Suppression Bolt, and Banish, Astral Vanishing, and Planar Grounding. Icy Blast is good against barbarians, pretty much. Other than that, it's hit or miss if you really want to take it. If you can make it work, take it. If not, I wouldn't worry about it all that much. Suppression Aura and Suppression Bolt are great against casters. Suppression Aura stops them from using any spells for 60 seconds, and Suppression, 30 seconds, and then Suppression Bolt is 60 seconds. Now, of course, it can stop everyone else from using their abilities as well, but I still personally find Break Concentration to be quicker and more effective, because it's not necessarily stopping them altogether, it's delaying them so your allies can get up there and kill them themselves. Destroy Armor is good against somebody who has a lot of armor in one location. Like, for example, that warrior is bullying your team. Oh crap, I'm out of pyrotechnics, or I didn't even take pyrotechnics. Destroy his chest armor, then it makes it a little bit easier to get rid of him, because then somebody can come up and backstab him, for example. Not very good against the, if you're just targeting a limb, because that one's gone, but they may guard that one more often now. So it's going to be harder to get to that. If you want to just take out armor individually, pyrotechnics, like I said, or a fireball would also be really good for that. Shatter weapon is okay, a little lengthy, but I would rather use heat weapon or just hit it with one of your spell balls. In this combination that I have, you got both lightning bolt and fireball, which both break weapons as well. So that works as well. Throw is a good move because it moves them back 50 feet rather than just the 20 shove does, but it is a per refresh spell. This one I'm not saying you shouldn't take, but it's just not as resourceful. Shove is a little bit easier to take because it's per life. Excuse me. Ravage is a good spell for weakening somebody significantly. It makes them fragile, so one hit on a limb, they're done. Needless to say. But as an, it's also wordy, and we were talking earlier, and we agree, Ravage and Wounding, wordiest combination ever for the wizards. Which, not used often either. And then you've got Astral Intervention. It puts someone in the insubstantial state, which essentially knocks them out of the game for a little while, but they can pull themselves out of it. It's just not a personal favorite of mine, but I have seen it used in a very good way. And the last two, Banish and Planar Grounding, are only good against a couple classes, really, and that's your Scout or Assassin, because Banish can be comboed with Astral Intervention to put someone back at home base, but it's only a temporary fix, and it's not, like, extremely useful. Lastly is your Entangle Spellball. Great for stopping everyone except for Barbarian. So personally, I would rather just ping them with a Lightning Bolt, because you're either going to stop them, or you're going to hit their body and you're going to possibly even kill them. So Lightning Bolt's a little bit more effective on that. Alright, now let's move into the nitty-gritty of everything. What enchantments are best for certain classes? As I said earlier, Pro Mag can be good for just about every class, really. Every class can find a use for it, whatsoever. Barbarians, of course, cannot take enchantments, so they're being excluded altogether. Promage is also the only enchantment a paladin can use. Alright, so let's go on a little bit. Quick overview. Void Touch, most powerful one. It gives you Curse, but you also get Steel Life Essence Unlimited, and it specifically says it goes through the Curse State. Adrenaline, Vampire-esque. Vampirism. You get Adrenaline that pushes through the Curse State as well. And then your last one is Contagion, which all of your weapons are wounds kill, but you are fragile, so that's only good for like someone with like really heavy armor. Alright, now I did put together a short list of the best way to deal with each class, but as I am told, my time is starting to get a little bit low, so if you guys want to hear more about that, it'd be good source for the Q&A.
Alrighty, so we're all done. You're fine ending there, Berrian? Alright.
Yep, I'll go on later.
So, everyone, digital clap for Berrian. Thank you for that take on Wizard as a support. Now, before we move on to our Paragons, we are going to quickly plug our sponsors. I made this nice little thing. Let's see if it loads up. Bam! There we go. So I'm sure you guys have heard the Phoenix League and the Paragon Academy is sponsored by Warlord Sports. They help out a lot of the Ampgard communities by giving prize support, and they do so for us. So here's our little plug for them. WarlordSports.com, home of the Waxcalibur, home of Aethertube. You can get shields, weapons, garb. They make stuff for Dag, Bell, Ampgard, and I think there's one more that I'm missing, but you can go to their website and see for yourself, www.warlordsports.com, for more information. Thanks. And that was our regular, our plug. So, now we are moving on to our two Paragon speakers. Tenebrus is having some issues, so we are going to go with him first, just to make sure he doesn't fizzle out of existence on us. So, Tenebrus, you want to unmute yourself? Just confirm that you are there, since I can't visually see you. All right, Tenebrus is here. So, Tenebrus will be talking to us about mastering the basics. So, I don't know what that's going to contain, because that's all I have in my notes. So, without further ado, everybody, Paragon Wizard Tenebrus.
Hello. So, I apologize first and foremost that y'all can't see me, but you're not missing much. My mug is quite ugly. My apprentice can attest to that. But yeah, my topic today is mastering the basics. For those of us that have been playing a while, we can often look back on the days of V6 and V7 quite fondly, when it took us 3 months to go from level 1 to level 2. And I hated that. It took forever to level up. And in V8 now it takes, you know, a very short 4 weeks, which is, of course, no time at all. And so what I've noticed since V8 came about is that a lot of our wizards, and not only wizards, just a lot of the spellcasters, as they level up, they actually start ignoring their lower level spells and how useful some of those spells can be. So a lot of my lecture is focused on don't ignore the bottom third of your spell list. and more importantly, don't ignore the things that come with it. pardon me, I have I'm getting over a cold. But when you're a level 1 wizard, I wish this was part of the Q&A. I wish I could have a show of hands here, but I'm betting that all of you used Shove as like your go-to, this is one of my bread and butter most useful spells. And Shove far and away is incredibly useful, partly because it's innately chargeable, that and along with Heat Weapon. And those two spells being spells that are chargeable are just incredibly useful. And the reason that they're so useful is because both of them have a vast array of situations. Berrian talked a little bit about both of those, so I'm going to not yak your all's ears off, except to say that they're incredibly useful spells. And then, in fact, Berrian went over a good chunk of what I maybe was going to talk about. But, no, they're very useful spells, and a big part of why they're useful is that they're chargeable. In the Paragon Academy, one of the first trials I was assigning to our wizards was to get their charge incantation as fast as possible. A big part of what makes you a talented wizard is knowing when and where to use those experienced abilities and when and where to use your charge abilities. And yeah, I mean, that's a huge part of it. So the basics of a wizard are knowing what your low-level spells are going to be and knowing the charge incantations. So that's most of what I have to talk about. If you move up into the level 2 spells, you'll notice that the level 2 spell list is actually, in my opinion, kind of devoid of stuff that's useful at higher levels. Level 2 is the points that I actually most often drop. But it does have a couple of standout favorites, which I think both previous speakers have touched on, which is the Entangle spell. So if you're an aspiring Paragon wizard, take a look at that level 2 list, make sure you understand what's on it, and make sure you understand how good then those other spells are. And then level 3 up is like is when wizard hits its power curve. So starting to level 3, which takes only as long as it used to take to get to level 2, you actually start to really get into your power combos. Level 3 has probably a perennial favorite, and in fact, I think Wizo and I spent a good week going over whether or not this was better than my personal favorite, but a perennial favorite being the Lightning Bolt and Drag Below combo. Level 4 introduces Icy Blast and Shatter as a combo, and we know that. We've been over and over and over it. The basic premise behind both of those combos is the same, in that one of your two spells is a spell that you put the experienced ability from level 1 onto, and now that spell can be recharged, and you can either put experienced on both Icy Blast and Shatter, or you can put experienced on just Drag Below. And regardless of what you do, you now have an infinitely reusable way of getting kills. And I won't go into the efficiencies of either one, but suffice it to say that 9 times out of 10, it's better to have just a spell ball and Drag Below versus 2 verbal spells. But when you have proper team support, so in the case of Icy Blast and Shatter, for example, if you're playing Battle Mage, if you have a team that backs you up, it actually has things like a bard who has confidence, things like that, that makes that, in my opinion, that combo becomes stronger. But, you know, it's not as efficient because you can't use it as much. The other basics behind Wizard, if you look at the design, obviously, is that we are the most aggressive magic casting class. Everything I've touched on so far, I think, actually just kind of point towards that. You have a lot of spells that just say, target player who is insert state dies. So you have spells that take out target insubstantial player, target frozen player, target stopped player. If that exists, we have a way to kill them. And so, again, the basics for Wizard is, you know, being able to use those spells to target players, get kills, and sort of run the field. And Lauxus touched on this with Elemental Barrage. It has a massive effect when you use it on the front lines, and that you can just blow huge holes in enemy lines. Berrian talked about this with a support wizard. Support wizard is more than capable of, you know, knocking out huge chunks of enemy lines with control spells, but then you have a massive piece of your list that's basically capable of going through and mopping all those players up. And that, to me, is like the basic essence of a wizard, is inflict states, kill players. If you're looking at the basics of V8, it's use your teammates to inflict states, so find a friendly healer or druid who has Iceball or Entangle and let them deal with your opponents, and then you follow through and kill them. One of my favorite things to do, actually, when I have someone to actually throw spell balls for me. Other than that, the number one piece of advice I can give anyone who wants to play a wizard is to learn that charge incantation. It takes very little effort to master it. If you start learning it at level 1, by the time you reach level 6, you should be capable of rattling off a charge times 10 in under 30 seconds. If you're not doing that, you're not ready for Paragon. So that's my bit. And I apologize for technical difficulties that happened.
Oh, okay. Coming in nice and short. That is fine with us. I'm sure you've got you. If you can stick around for the Q&A, that will have plenty more good questions for you there. We had a couple come in actually while you were talking. So if you can make it to the Q&A, Tenebrus, hopefully, that would be really awesome. So yeah, digital clap for Tenebrus. Thank you very much for that discussion on mastering the basics. And with that, we are moving on to our final speaker before the Q&A. He is another Paragon instructor from the Academy. He is the most active of our wizard instructors right now. Actually, I wanted to mention before we went into that, Tenebrus came in when we started the Academy, and he was one of the main wizard instructors for the longest time, and helped get the wizard community in the Academy going. So I just wanted to give him a in-video shout-out for that, for helping. And now that he's kind of taking some time to move and to do some things in his life, we have Wizo coming in, picking up that mantle, and he's really been carrying the class for the latter half of things. So, with that out of the way, thank you both for what you've done, and now we're going to go into Wizo, who is going to talk about playing Wizard in large-scale games and short swords. Not playing games in short swords, but playing games and short swords. Anyway, here you go, Paragon Wizard Wizo.
All right, thank you very much for that. Thank you again, Woonjo. And hello, you sexy people, especially you sexy wizards. You chose the right class. After all, we are the master class. But I'm going to talk to you about, as he said, big games and short swords. A little bit of background for me, since the beginning was a little bit of confusion for the land that I'm in, or kingdom that I'm in. I used to be in Northern Lights for like 10 years. I had to move to Idaho. I was used to a bigger land where at the lowest time it was like 20 numbers, average around like 40, sometimes even at like 60 people, and it just fluctuated based on the year, yada yada. So when I played in smaller fields, or especially since moving to Idaho, where the closest park to me is 80 miles away, and I only go once every 2 weeks, and it's very noobish and very small, I've noticed a lot of differences in small games. And for most people, when going to large events, people have said that it's different, and they kind of don't know what to do entirely because it's a different type of field. For me, it's the exact opposite, where at small games, there's some strange things that have happened. But I'm going to talk to you about my main experience in big games and how to maximize yourself and your potential. So, here we go into it. First of all, if you are at a big park, like let's say 20, 40 people, whatever else, you don't need to adhere to this, but at events, this is when this is crucial. Take one of every spell ball except Suppress, and possibly Spear. So the reason behind this is that when you throw your spell ball, you probably won't get it back for a while. But other people will throw spell balls at you or your teammates, So you can pick them up, because usually they'll all say spellball share beforehand, because they'll not be able to use spellballs afterwards. So you pick those spellballs up, and you chuck them back at the enemy. The reason why not suppress and possibly spear is because, universally, people do not take suppress that much, and there are reasons for that. Not going to go into it. Unimportant. But all you need to know is it's not usually taken. And spear is also an iffy one. It's good. More people take spear than suppress, but that's kind of up to you because it's also 2 6-level points. But overall, you want your lightning bolts, fireballs, ice balls, and entangles especially. Those lower spell balls are what you definitely need, even if you don't usually take them, so you can throw them back at people when you're at big events. So that's a good tip to always have. After that, there is a problem with verbals that people have stated. They've stated that, oh, if I go battle mage, if I go verbals, are going to be useless in big games because I was at keep and then I just pointed this person. They don't really matter because they can't hear me or whatever else. Verbals have a myth and a reality. The myth is that they cannot do anything like they stated. The reality is that they cannot do anything like they stated in certain instances. Kind of important to note. If you are in the middle of a giant line and you're like, hey, you warrior, as you point to a warrior in the back and there's like 4 warriors in front of you, your verbal is probably not going to go off because they're not going to know who you're talking to. Verbals at bigger battle games are very useful in a pocket. So instead of just pure lines, there will be sometimes this little pocket of non-fighting happening, and then the line goes on to another pocket, and then it goes on because there's some random stalemate. And you can call to people on the edges of those pockets if you're fighting in there or while flanking. That is when verbals are actually effective and the most effective, or when they're right in front of you. So verbals are able to work. People don't just think you can only use spell balls, but you have to be loud and have to express it. Be like, warrior with armor, I command you to stop, I command. So there's a little bit of, there was a little loud, and also I said warrior with armor specifically, because at an event, you'll be surprised how many warriors don't have armor. It's really weird, but it's true, because there are new people playing warriors. Continuing on, a strange thing that I've seen at lower fields is that you kind of have to plan out where you are. You're kind of alone a lot. At bigger events, you'll always have a meat shield next to you. Now, meat shield is anyone who is not a wizard and should definitely be in front of you to take any shot because that is their main purpose in life. So if they're to your right or to your left, you'll usually have a meat shield and you'll usually be able to adjust or wheel around them. If someone tries to shoot at you, you can usually go behind them and you don't need to worry about as much as just being alone and in the open, which helps you a lot with your defensiveness. And it's really, really strange on a small field because I can see that mentality shifting to where you pay a lot of extra attention to your surroundings rather than just knowing you'll be around a meat shield. Now, this mentality usually works out very well when you're in a line or in the middle of a line. But if you're not in the middle of a line, then yeah, you kind of have to be more aware. The other main thing is constant targets. In a big battle game, you need to be constantly spewing spells. You can't just be like, hey, I'm going to blow my load. I'm going to charge times 20 or some other thing like that. Or whatever else. Or I'm going to go find my buddy, the bard, over there. Because something else that's important in a big battle game is, yes, you use teammates. You talk beforehand, be like, all right, give me that gift of air so I can be unstoppable. Or, all right, you're going to confidence me and you're going to do this and we're all going to be great. But the truth is, we are fighters, not soldiers. When we go on our own, well, we go on our own a lot, which kind of destroys teamwork sometimes, unless you have really good friends or they're dedicated friends. Now, this works really well on small fields, but if you go to an event where you don't know many people, and there's a bard, and you're like, hey, I want you to confidence me, and they're like, all right, well, they're probably not going to confidence you because you can't find them. So that's something that you want to be aware of, is that you need to be able to, if you have a build planning on that, you need to basically have them on a leash where you know where they are, which is difficult, but a lot of people make that mistake where they go to a bigger game, they say this is going to work out well, and it doesn't really work out. And that's why, in my opinion, having a lot of spells and a lot of ways to affect the battlefield and constantly affecting it is better. Because if you're able to constantly affect the battlefield, then you're able to constantly make a difference, which is really what us wizards are, is being the main fear on the battlefield. Which brings me to my next point of fear. It doesn't happen right away, but if you're able, if you're at an event and you keep killing people with spells and you keep making yourself known as a presence, and you keep killing them in ways that are just downright wrong and terrible to where they can't ever find a way to kill you, then eventually they get some fear and it spreads to other people, which you'd be surprised how quickly it actually spreads. Now, the point of why this is important in bigger battle games instead of smaller battle games is that initially, if you're going to just a camp out and this isn't in your kingdom or you haven't been really known in your kingdom, this makes people talk about you. That, oh, this person's actually stopped me. This person's actually kept going. This person doesn't shut up and keeps affecting everyone. It brings out a small essence of fear, which people start to overcome at first with their bonds trying to pick on you. But that makes you a target and makes a whole bunch of people focus on you. And if people can focus on you, you can actually lead them away to a certain part, create openings, create pockets that you can affect people in, and also it makes you get yourself noticed. Lastly, in big battle games, kill the healer. If you can, kill the killer. It's not always possible, but if you can get an extension, if you can go around and kill them, don't do it in a suicidal attempt. I've seen too many people try it, but these are just a few small little tips on big battle games. We can go over a few more in the discussion section and everything else. But that's just a little bit, which I've talked to people and they don't really have a natural sense for bigger battle games, especially the picking one spell ball of each type to throw back at the end. Now on to the next subject of it. Instead of just little tips, we're going to be actually having a real discussion. Short source. This one's a little broken because kind of stuck there. I mean, it's not stuck there. It just keeps going. So, aside from hitting someone with a broken short sword, a short sword is a fixed one, an illegal one. Is the best purchase you can make at level 1, and it is also the most suicidal purchase you can make at level 1. Why is this? Well, let's first go into the benefits of why you would pick a short sword. Now, a short sword lets us do many things. First, it lets us pretend we're a Jedi. Very important. But it also gives us the ability to fight other people that we weren't able to before. Laxus was saying, as, for example, oh, a battle mage is fighting a monk. They can't do anything to him. Well, I have a short sword, so I can fight. Or you could be like, well, there's that armored warrior coming at me, and I don't have any spell points ready. Well, I have a short sword, so I can fight him. Or all these other weird situations where your short sword lets you do a whole bunch of things where it's not, where you wouldn't be able to otherwise. Secondly, it's a good blocking tool. You're able to block arrows, you're able to block poles, you're able to actually be a threat and be a Jedi when you do it. I keep mentioning Jedi because I just have envisioned in my mind a battle mage with 28 shoves just going out there and messing with people with a short sword. But a short sword has many potential benefits, and most people take it. So, it gives you also more option and makes you more of a threat. Those are the general gist of a short sword, and we like having short swords because we weren't able to in V7, and now we've also trained with short swords, and we actually have them in tournaments. Now, let's see the negatives of it. You're going to fight with a short sword. As a wizard, that's a terrible negative. Why? I have a short sword. I could buy a long sword if I spend 4 5th level points, but then I shouldn't be playing a wizard. So, I have a short sword. I can only purchase one. I'm going to fight a druid. They have a better weapon loadout. I'm going to fight a healer. They have a better weapon loadout. I'm going to fight a warrior. Everyone has a better weapon loadout than you. And, yes, I see you, Wunjo. And, everyone has a better weapon loadout than you. So, initially, you had an innate disadvantage, and it's not the smartest to actually go and fight with a short sword versus most people, especially when they have other enchants and other things like that. Along those lines, when you have a short sword, you'll think that you'll be able to fight them. You reflexively go when someone charges you to fighting with a short sword. And when you do that, you're making a mental leap from spell casting and knowing the entire field to one-on-one targets. First of all, you're a good wizard. You have a giant target painted on you. You not being aware of the field and focusing one-on-one makes it so that you're more likely to get hit with your surroundings. And also, you're coming off the bench cold. You're not warmed up. Well, that other person is usually, since they're like a monk or fighter or something else. And you have to make that mental shift from spells, the entire field, to fighting with a short sword. Because spells and weapons are a little bit different mentally, or a mental category, when you're fighting. And I've seen this happen a lot with wizards. A lot of people freeze up. The general time is about 0.2 seconds. With very experienced wizards with short swords, to, and that's almost none, to 1.2 seconds with a longer time for other newer wizards who aren't used to that transition. Now, our strength is also in our spells. If we kill someone with a short sword, they're like, oh, you killed me. But if you kill someone with some bullcrap combo that they don't even know about because they didn't read the rule book, they're just like, oh, you're cheap. Terrible. I don't want to fight you. But then you've also made them begrudgingly accept that you are better than them because you know more and you're actually able to do more than what they can understand. And people hate what they don't understand. So just keep that in mind. Along with that, daggers. I don't have my dagger with me. I should have gotten that. But daggers are also able to block just as easily and possibly more easily because instead of going this way over with how long it takes, with a dagger, it's actually quicker. It doesn't cover as much length with the blade, but you're able to maneuver it quicker and possibly block more reflexively. Having a dagger would also make you rely more on spells, or not having a short sword would make you rely on your spells, which is also what us wizards are really good at doing. And really, that's the main thing about short sword. It is the most powerful purchase you can make at level 1 because it lets you do a whole bunch of extra things, but it also is the most suicidal because it makes you do these things which are possibly stupid beyond belief. And then you don't even think about it. You're just like, I can fight in a tournament, or I've been training as a short sword, and then you go into fight without actually relying on your spells, which is the strength of a wizard, since our weapon loadout is crap compared to others. But then again, it does negate other options like what Lax is saying. So take short sword as you will. There's a full description of why a short sword is good and bad, and why you should be careful when purchasing it. That's all I'm going to say.
Is that it? Are you all done?
Yeah, I said that's all I'm going to say on it. So. All
right. So, everybody give one more nice digital clap for Wizo. Thank you very much, Wizo. I learned a lot there, because I definitely don't play in enough big games. So, we're now going to move into our Q&A. As I understand it, Tenebrus needs to depart. So, everyone say goodbye to Tenebrus. Tenebrus, if you want to leave some final comments, you can do so.
I'm here.
You're sexy.
I vanished suddenly, and you just knew my phone battery died.
Oh, okay. So you're still here?
Yeah, I'm here for now. We'll see how long we make it.
All right. Okay. We will know that Tenebrus is gone when all the videos skew out of their boxes. So here we are at the at our Q&A. Feel free to type into the live chat. I've got some tracked from what was mentioned during the lectures, and I'm going to go be checking the email as well. So let's do the question that literally just popped up here from Baranduin. Wizo mentioned targeting healers. What is his go-to strategy for taking them out?
So it depends where they are, and it depends on your spell loadout. In bigger games, I generally do the generalist. I generally go to generalist. So I'm very good with throwing spell balls. I'm able to hit them 50, 60 feet out and fine with that. So what I do is while they're charging, I generally do ice ball. It's not a kill, but it stops them. It makes people go to them, and it makes people look back. It gives an opening, and I try to push people forward to go and kill the healer if I try to do it. Killing the healer is hard. My favorite way of doing it is just going Warlock, Eight Fingers of Death, Extension, Dispel. I mean, not Extension, Dispel. Extension, Finger of Death. And that's really my favorite way of killing them. But in all honesty, it's extraordinarily hard. If I really want to kill a healer, I can go Extension, Icy Blast, Shatter, but I wouldn't do that. I would never do that. It depends on the distance. Usually in a bigger game, it's harder to get to a healer. But if it's a smaller game, stop, suppress, murder, however you want. And by stop, I mean if you're a battle mage, hold person, suppress, kill, usually, is the easiest way to kill a healer if you're in a smaller game or if they're skirmished a little bit. My favorite is battle healers. They're so easy to do that.
Any input from the other guys here? You're all on screen, by the way, just so you know. You can feel free to unmute yourself and talk however you'd like.
I will definitely
like the Finger of Death myself, personally, so.
I've actually done the Icy Blast Shatter combo to a healer midway through a big game. It's amazing when you do it if you can break a running res train, but it's Yeah, like, I would never waste an extension in that scenario, ever. It's only, like, a battle mage.
Alright, so let's go backwards through the questions here. The last question before that, the question directly was, how do wizards deal with their inflated egos?
That we're better than all of you. The question
can, though, be interpreted as, how do you stop from getting overconfident and overextending? That kind of thing. Because wizards have a lot of, you can front load yourself and think you are, you know, the master of the universe. How do you stop from that getting to your head and running into your death or overextending yourself?
Die a few times.
Well,
remember your squishy.
I say, first off, realize you are better than everyone else. Second, accept that because you are better than everyone else, you have a target painted on you. And that means you need to be cautious of whoever wants to kill you. That caution will keep you alive, and also your arrogance will partially keep you alive as well. Secondarily, only take a dagger, and you'll get really good at reflexively blocking things, especially arrows. Like, at this point, I could not even pay attention to an archer. An archer shoots at me, and I've done this so many times where I just reflexively block with a dagger that it's ridiculous. But get really good reflexes is another way, especially with that constant fear of just, well, not fear, but paranoia. It's not really paranoia if it's true. So.
Anyone else?
I have almost the same advice, except for I tell people, and I've done this to some academy students, take the field with no weapons at all, not even a dagger. You will quickly remember exactly how squishy you are, and after two or three games worth of that, that tends to beat out of most people at that tendency to really, like, run up ahead and get blown up because their team is 20 feet behind them.
Along with that, if you don't take a short sword, that does the same thing, because you realize, I can't fight anyone in melee.
Yeah.
Berrian Lauxus, anything you want to chip in on that?
Most time, it's just like I get killed a few times, and I'm like, okay, I gotta play it smarter.
All right,
yeah,
so...
Yeah, I'm with him, I just...
Don't carry on, it's all right.
I was just saying, I'm with him, I just remember, oh hey, I'm a squishy, I died pretty damn easily, so back off a little.
Fair enough. All right. So, moving on, I'll just go from the top now. So, one of the first questions we got asked was, what are some creative uses for pro magic? Or creative ways of using pro magic?
Get the bear and pro mag is my favorite go-to. I mean, get the bear, the only way you can die is crushing and breaking melee weapons. Pro mag takes away any enchant that would grant crushing and breaking. So, it has to be a true melee weapon wielded by a barbarian or meets crushing and breaking standard to actually not trigger your gift of air.
Mm-hmm. That's a fun one.
You will still, important note there, that your armor, if you're wearing armor or ancestral armor or something like that and you have gift of air, that is not protected by gift of air. So, they break through all your armor first, and then once they finally hit you, then you've bamf away.
Yeah. There was this huge thing in the last camp that we were at where I had a druid put stone skin and gift of air on me. This was about a year ago. And it caused the whole kingdom's Reeves to hate me because I have to put that on the Reeves test now because I deliberately screwed with them on that. I thought it would work and I wouldn't lose the armor points at that point. Since I don't know armor chance.
No, technically, I think you actually do not lose the armor points unless it's crushing and breaking, because Gift of Air says if you are struck, it triggers
it. It has been clarified that your armor is separate from you. So your armor is separate from you. So any armor, magical or physical, if somehow you're playing some sort of monster that has wizard abilities and that, you lose your armor first, and then once you yourself are hit, that's when the Gift of Air triggers.
Yep, and you can't choose which ones trigger. You trigger them both simultaneously as well. So, that's an important note that we found out, and a lot of Reeves still
that was the back to the question for ProMag, I've seen ProMag used to amazing effect on someone that was attuned with another enchantment before getting the ProMag. I think I saw, goodness, I think it was like ProMag and then like Gift of Fire or something like that, where they had they could handle just about insanity scenario. And if you put those things like that on high-level stick players, Chromag is wonderful. Because those players don't care about a lot of magic all of a sudden, and they can just wade through and act like it's a ditch. That's one of the few times I can see that spell being incredibly useful.
Yeah.
So, we did have a correction. The question apparently was, how do you guys fight against Pro-Magic? Creative ways to fight against Pro-Magic.
Dispel.
Dispel. Face paint bolts.
Yeah.
All right.
So if I think Pro-Mag is easy and difficult, Pro-Mag you can, as they just said, phase bolt's a great way of doing it, but an ambulant Dispel Magic will keep you alive and get your Dispel Magic off, usually for sure, because people with Pro-Mag usually charge. Not usually, well, enchants don't necessarily always charge, but people with Pro-Mag especially always charge. So if you have an ambulant Dispel Mage, that is the best way, in my opinion, to get rid of Dispel Mage. I mean, to get rid of Pro Mage. Because usually it's persistent.
Alright.
Yeah. Oh, absolutely. Yeah.
No, if you got more, keep going.
Oh, no, I was just gonna say, we started it on Loken, I think, it's just, you have, two options for dealing with it. The Ambulant Dispel, if you're really, really capable of talking that quickly, a non-Ambulant Dispel, but that's rare. I don't even think I'm that fast,
and you'll probably die, too.
Yeah, you might take the death as you finish your last syllable. Then you gotta call Reeves.
Or you'd have to do a swift tally anyway, so it's just like,
eh. Alright, next question. Someone asked about strategies or practice tips to improve their charge speed, but I believe this can go towards just incantation speed in general. So take it away, whoever wants to go first.
You want to go first, Tenebrus, on this?
Sure. So the biggest thing that I can talk to people about on that, as far as improving your incant speed, is that pick a specific incantation to get really good at first. And I actually, in my instant case, I learned how to do the charge incantation really, really quickly before I even bothered trying to get good at other incantations, because charge in particular has a lot of places where you can flub it. And so you get good at paying attention to and learning the rhythm to an incantation. Some of the best activities you can do are vocal exercises and warm-ups before a battle game. I have previously, I don't do this as much now because I don't play Wizard as often lately, but I will do vocal warm-ups. I will literally zing-a-zing-a-zoo, zing-a-zing-a-zoo, zing-a-zing-a-zing-a-zoo, and try and loosen up my vocal cords before a game just so I'm able to speak faster. Something else that I did just in general is every day, I used to have a 20-minute commute to work, so every day I'd pick a different incantation, and I would repeat it constantly, all the way to work. And then I would do the same thing all the way home, just on repeat, until I was really, really good at it. Repetition is king for getting good at incantations.
Yeah, perfect repetition. The only thing I could add to that is, you already hit the best one, is on your way to work or in the car, because then no one can judge you, and you can feel like you can do whatever you want with it. But do it
before
you... on the bus, then you'll get a whole bunch of people around you, they'll just be banging, it's really great, so it's always good. But when you practice it, make sure you enunciate is a good way of doing it, because sometimes they can muddle. For example, I call upon the weapon, I call upon the weapon, I call upon the weapon. I call upon flame to heat the weapon, muddled, but I didn't accentuate any syllables, but I call upon flame to heat that weapon. How I can do it now is, I call upon flame to heat that weapon, I call upon flame to heat that weapon, I call upon flame to heat that weapon. See how I'm accentuating certain parts of it so that people can understand it. Along with that, you probably will get a better volume is usually better while practicing. Unless you're on the bus, then maybe not. But accentuating and will get you more audible, more speed, and also increase your volume in addition to what Tenebra said, because those are all really good ones that you already put out, man.
All right, moving onward. Next in line is someone asked for some examples of large event spell lists, or I guess in this case, spells that are better in a large event setting that might not be as good when you're like 6-on-6, that kind of thing.
There's a few things. It depends on the game. I would say Evoker is the best at punching a hole. Now, that could be at a castle game. It's good at punching a hole.
wherever else. It could be even a forest when you're going to have a lot of downtime, but Invoker is really good at punching a hole through certain objectives. Bridge battle, castle game, whatever like that. If you're doing a game where you just want to kill as many as you can, then Warlock is really good. I mean, that's obvious there. But Battle Mage, I'd say, is one that I would not recommend for large games, because Battle Mage, again, relies on verbal, so either you're going to charge a lot for your refreshes or run out, or you're going to go through your pro-lives, and unless you have a bard that takes restoration, which for some reason is not common among bards, don't know why, it's not common to have experience restoration with Song of Power or Confidence for 4 points for infinite recharge, but if you don't have a bard that has restoration and experience it, that you know, you're probably going to run out of spells as Battle Mage, or you're going to spend a lot of time charging, or it's not really good because you're not able to throw those spell balls back. So I recommend not having Battle Mage, usually at big events.
I agree with that. Battle Mage, in my opinion, every big event I've been to, Keep, Noah, or everything like that, Battle Mage has not done well.
No.
For larger games, Battle Mage is probably the weakest list. You have to be really, really good. I would say for larger games, the best decisions that I've seen players making is to choose to really, really hyper-specialize. Lauxus, for example, at Keep, we were just talking about this separately or away from the chat, did something like 20 heat weapons on a list, I think. I don't know, Lauxus.
Well, I took Warlock and dropped all of my first level and second level points into Heat Weapon and just stood on the front lines and took Monk's Poles away so they'd have to drop them. And it got to the point where another wizard came up, separate from me, started yelling at a monk that I had taken as a weapon away 11 times. Monk just drops his weapon, and the guy was, I looked at the wizard and he was like, I don't even have Heat Weapon. So I was like, I'm doing a good job.
Someone's asking why not Battle Mage? Like, wouldn't the infinite ambulance help you keep moving?
Oh, I got it. I think it works best in skirmishes, not in, like Wizzo said, he was talking skirmishes on the outsides, where like I've done it. I've gone to the outsides and seen, you know, there's maybe like a pocket of fighters fighting. You can get in there, you can get somebody's attention much faster. But when the chaos breaks, everybody's doing their own thing, and nobody's going to stop to listen to you.
Yeah. And well, here's the other part with it. So, like how I said in my big games, you can't do it line to line. It's weakness. You have to find the pockets or the side parts. So you're limited to those pockets and side parts as well with what Lauxus was saying. But also the main reason is Battle Mage is the best, in my opinion, used for control. So you can kill still. You still have to kill things. Control and infinite life. Quick respawn games, or when you have someone to refresh those paralyzed. Because again, you're going to run out of your verbals a lot, because you'll run out of your per refreshes, definitely, and you're going to charge, or you'll run out of all your paralyzed unless you have a dedicated bar for restoration, because if you're doing things correctly, you should be spouting off so many spells that you can affect at least 10 people at a time if you're going to really go Battle Mage at a big event. And to affect a lot of people at a time in a big event with them paying attention to you only is nigh impossible while also keeping your spells up. That's the benefit of spell balls. They'll be thrown back and forth each time, and you throwing them back or having, again, 20 heat weapons like Warlock doubles it. I mean, Warlocks are only a big spell increase, so you will run out, which is the main weakness of Battle Mage in big games, to my opinion.
Yeah, no, you're absolutely right. The biggest weakness for Battle Mage is that your enemy is longevity. The longer the game runs, the more likely it is that you're going to be a guy who has no spells remaining and a dagger. Or you're going to find yourself in a situation where you don't have the spell you need at all. For a big game, if you're going into a big game with coordinated support, so for example, sorry, there's neighborhood kids. If you have knowingly ahead of time talk to a friend of yours who's planning to play Bard, or another wizard who's planning to hit you with like a persistent Void Touched, then Battle Mage becomes very viable, but you still have to play it smart, versus any other situation in a large game where you just can't run it. You have to have a way to mitigate the longevity issue to be able to make a Battle Mage work.
Yep. The only other large game to make it work is if you have infinite lives, infinite respawn. And the respawn is pretty close.
and they actually call refreshes during the game, which I've been to one major event where they actually had refreshes happening during a big battle game once.
If they have refreshes in battle games, that overpowers spellcasters so much. If they have like 15-minute refreshes, like that's...
Well, at that point, we're gods.
Yeah, we are. That's what most people do. That's why people are like, hey, spellcasters are the OP class, the master class. I'm like, well, if you give us the ability to thrive with giving us refreshes at like 15, 20 minutes, yeah, we're going to be gods. But if you extend it to like 30 minutes, then we're just like, ah, crap. We have to actually be equal with these guys and think and stuff. But, yeah.
So, still on the large battles, another question is, what are your favorite spells to experience for large battle games? If you're going to experience, I guess, anything.
Shatter. What? Oh, heat weapon? I usually have enough heat weapons where it doesn't matter where I have, like, 4 or 5. Because I drop a lot of points. I usually have, like, 9 points in my first level, and at big battle games, I don't even have short swords, so that's 9 points of first level ridiculousness. So I have like a lot of heat weapons, but Shatter is universally very applicable because you'll have warriors, you'll have you won't really have icy blast druids because it doesn't happen that often, or unless you icy blast, it's not going to happen that often. But you have a lot of ice balls going around, and you also have druids that are trying to stone form, and you can mess with them to where your teammates can kill them. I've done that quite a few times, but or you can just kill them without them realizing it. But Shatter is useful in a lot of ways. And and you may not get a ton of Shatter with 2 STLs, but really, all you need is every once in a while to do it, and it's great. Since I personally don't charge anything, charge times 5 or up, since I don't need to because I plan it out very well.
All right. So, tying into the experienced question, someone asked, do you feel Suppress Aura is worth experiencing at all?
I don't feel worth
taking.
No. Should not be on your list. If you're a Paragon Wizard, you should never have had it at all.
So here's the reason why we say that, is because Suppress Aura and Break Concentration are meant to give you an edge over other casters who are better than you, usually. Or if you just want to shut someone down so you can wreck them. Like, I mean, again, the healer holds Break Concentration so they can't run away. But Suppress Aura is 50 feet out. If they know they're suppressed, especially in a big battle game, 5 out of 9 classes have released. They're going to get released. It's not that big of a deal, really. I mean, you may make them burn a release in 5 seconds of it other time, but it's not that strong of a spell, especially to experience.
Yeah.
That's
important. Last question. I think one of my favorites to experience, and people are going to get on me for this, throw is one of my favorite things to experience. Because when I play Control Wizard, I don't take a weapon out. I'm not even kill anybody. I am just about, hey, you go over there, you go over there, you go over there, you leave me alone, you leave my friend alone, you leave my friend alone.
I like throw and shove to experience because, well, like I made my presentation, I like the control. So I agree with him on that one.
So, just for everyone who just noticed everything explode, Tenebrus, his battery just died, so he is no longer with us. So we're going into the background mode here to keep everyone on screen. So everyone is on screen except for Tenebrus right now, because he is no longer with us. So thank you, Tenebrus. If you watch this later, you tried as long as you could, but continue. Carry on with whatever you guys are saying.
So I guess we just move this question to control. My favorite control, for me, Battle Mage is pure control. I love Hold Person, probably from a V7 thing where it was Ambulin, but Hold Person is great if you're on a Battle Mage because you're able to, I usually get like 4 or 5 and it annoys the crap out of people, especially when you do it to them like 20 times. But Heat Weapon is also great. I wouldn't experience them because they're pro-life, but...
Hold Person has a big flaw with the Barbarians.
Oh, it does. It does.
Most of the time, they're going to... Yeah. My experience with the Barbarians at our park, we have a pretty large park, and we have a lot of Barbarians, and they just love to run up and brutal strike me. So Hold Person is not my... Throw is my thing to get them away from me as best I can.
Yeah, usually what I do to barbarians, if I'm only a battle mage, is I shove them, start to run after them a little bit, leg them, heat their weapon, and I just start toying with them. Or I start toying with them before I heat their weapon. I go behind them like, oh, am I going to kill you with a dagger? Oh, I have no way. Heat weapon. All right, so, and then when they put their weapon down, I'll just kick it away. I'm a dick, but if you do that, then they'll hate you and they'll feel like they can't fight you, which is awesome.
Well, I've done it to a couple of our barbarians, but I'll use Icy Blast and freeze him, and then I'll sit next to him and have a 30-second long conversation before I shatter him. And then I'll just walk away and go do something else.
It's good to mess with your prey and let them know that they're
not. No, absolutely. To you. I'm in control. You're not in control.
Exactly. There's nothing you could ever do.
Okay. Sorry, I'm just trying to readjust the overlay before. Next question. Right. I'm going to try to link these together so the knowledge flows properly. Let's go to this one. This is a question for Berrian again. Someone asked, what do you do if you're trying to do a support wizard and there's druids on the team? Because are you just completely outclassed? Why not? Why wouldn't you just switch to being kill at that point?
If you're versing druids, of course, everyone knows druids has release. Druids like to use release. I've experienced that. My small park, we have like one druid who shows up every once in a while, and his releases are the most annoying thing ever. So a lot of times I'll try to knock him out of the battle first, and then I'll go to crowd control the rest of the others.
I think what he's asking is why not play druid instead of a wizard as support. Is that more correct, Winjo?
No. It was what do you do for your druid builds when there is also a druid there? Like, do you feel that druids just go and push you out? Anything else you want to say on that?
Like I said, just
I have something to say about that, I guess.
Yeah.
We have a really good druid in our park who's a really good summoner. Enchantments of the Wazoo. And that's a great form of support for a team, but the amount of support that a wizard can give can vary all the way down to, I can put people places that a lot of my druids don't do. So I feel like a wizard has a niche. It should never feel below a druid in crowd control or support. We're on the same level. We just do it differently.
We also have to be more intelligent, too, with our spells. For example, one of my favorite supports as a wizard is when I teleport people. Mm-hmm. People don't think of it as a big thing. But you teleport someone around to, like, a corner, let's say a barbarian. They go, they murder all the casters, they die, they fight after death and kill everyone else. That's a better support than what the druid's 10 enchantments were. So we have to be more creative with our support.
Absolutely. I think creative is definitely the word that I was looking for.
Now, druids have teleports, and they can do this as well, but they're encouraged to just be like, oh, give some enchants, guys. All right. Win for me.
All right. Next question. Sorry, I'm catching up on chat here.
No exceptions.
I'll ask a next question, and then I'll catch up in chat. Okay, so we're moving into a couple things that all have to do with Phoenix Ball. Which of you guys have played Phoenix Ball, Phoenix League matches before? So I think it was everyone but Wizo. I have the overlay back up. Tenebrus is not here. You'll just have to admire the little Photoshop toaster picture.
Is it a dwarf picture?
Chat was commenting that he was a toaster, so we've got a little toaster with his face on it up in his
head
right now. So Phoenix Ball, playing Wizard for Phoenix Ball. Do you have any thoughts on that strat-wise? And then we'll go into some more specific questions after that.
Phoenix Ball is probably one game mode where I really like to throw on the crowd control for them, because whenever we played at my park, and again, I have a smaller park, I get that, doesn't work for everybody, but whenever we played, I literally just said, you stop, you're frozen, you can't do this, you can't do that, you can't do this, and then my team just gunned it. It seemed to work 5 out of the 6 times that we played.
I like to make it a little more fun for the enemy team, because that does happen. So what I will do is I will sit behind the trash can where you drop the ball at the goal, and I'll just sit there, crisscross applesauce, and throw people when they get close.
Okay, that's hilarious.
I know I play trash can goalie. Leave me alone. I'm a good goalie.
I think when we played Goblin Ball when it was coming in, which I was told Phoenix Ball is kind of modded after.
If you imagine was... Goblin Ball where anyone can touch the ball, you're fairly close.
Okay. So I believe that actually was where I officially got my Paragon, because I went Battle Mage and I just controlled the living hell out of people and did a crap ton of verbals. And I'm able to run my mouth a lot, as you could probably tell already, and I just don't stop. So Battle Mage would always be my recommendation because it's a short... it doesn't have infinite lives.
This game does have infinite lives. Change. Yes, it does. But you're...
But what's the death count?
45.
Okay, that's a bit long for
yes.
it.
Yes.
So... That's actually a lot harder then, because we...
Don't worry. You'll be able to answer some of these more specific questions, because they're not necessarily Phoenix Ball related. They're just more apt to apply to Phoenix Ball. Personally, because I play Wizard when I'm playing Phoenix Ball, something that I've noticed is good is just stopping and shoving people when you're trying to make an advance. Either hold person, lightning bolt, entangle... Stop them because they're trying to block their goal or trying to get in the way of whoever has the ball, and just shove them out of the way, right? So now either their support needs to fall back to them in order to release them, or you just be like, you stay there, I'm going to go score. That's a good way to get them out of the way.
And also another thing, that also, if there's a bard on your team, just play Elemental Barrage, because the bard's going to do all the CC, and they're really good. So, might as well just go punch holes with fireballs.
Yeah, pretty much.
I'm going to play this right now. After May 6th, which is our next big Phoenix League event, we will be doing another one of these Paragon Academy Lives with the winning team of that event. So, it'll be purely talking about Phoenix Ball with a legit team that has been put together for the event. So, hopefully, you guys can come back for that. Moving on to more questions. This is a question that was asked way early on. How do Wizards and Cardio get along?
Famously.
Great. Here's the truth of it. If you are overweight, Wizard may not be a class for you because, again, you're going to be targeted a lot. You have to run around a lot. You have to be able to dodge and move around and try to weave and die. Well, not die. But, you know, get out of the way whenever you can. And you're going to be targeted, so you have to get out of there. I mean, the fantasy thing of, like, having the old fat wizard and everything is probably not the best in Amp Guard, because you need to be moving a lot. Like, you need to be positioning yourself, and you just need to be able to move a lot. So cardio gets along really well with wizards, especially being able to run and move while talking this much.
And I've never heard of an armchair wizard ever.
No,
you can't.
There's an armchair healers, but I've never heard of an armchair wizard.
So in V7, there used to be such things as armchair wizards, really, but in V8, it's impossible if you're going to play a somewhat decent wizard, because that's how our system now is designed to be. That you have to be active, and you have to be affecting, otherwise, you can't just throw a spell every 3 minutes.
I think to a certain extent, you know, we are playing a physical game, so the more in shape you are, the more you're going to excel in general. Right? Like, that's unfortunately a hard truth of a physical game, right? As much as it is known for or evolved off a game that is based, you know, like D&D and stuff like that, where the iconic player is that overweight guy sitting in his basement, this is still a sport type game. So the more in shape you are, the more you're going to be able to take advantage of any class.
Longer you can be in the fight.
Or the what?
Yeah.
The longer you can be in the fight.
Yes. Okay, so question that just popped up. Do you feel that Wizards taking advantage of... What? I'm going to read this verbatim. Do you feel like Wizards taking advantage of their ability of spells can frustrate new players to quite the game?
Yes.
Yes.
Yes. It's true. It's unfortunately true, but... It's also a strength for experienced players, because the person who only plays Warrior up to like 6th level and keeps playing Warrior doesn't know jack about spells. So it's part of the game, it's part of what you need to learn, and it also can interest new players. And that's when you'll also... It also lets you know if that person's going to really stick with Amp Guard or not, because spells are a huge part of this game. If you don't like spells at all, and you hate them, then you'll leave. But if you're interested, be like, wait, what happened? I kind of want to know more. Then, I mean, you may not even be a caster. You may just be wanting to play part of the game because you'll think that you can get more abilities as well, which is what Amgard really has. So it frustrates new players. It can, but it also tells them if they really want to play this game.
A good link off of that is monks. This was a question that was going around in the Paragon Academy of what everyone thought the best starting class for players were. And a lot of parks will go, you're new, play monk, and you don't have to worry about magic. But the general consensus actually has been, don't do that because you're teaching them to ignore the stuff that they should be learning. Do you guys agree or disagree?
I agree. I think that they should learn magic. I think that to have a new player have the most fun, Assassin is one of those classes where you have per life abilities, go die, play again, get a feel for the game, as opposed to Monk going, I can block this, and you're shouting at me, and it doesn't matter.
Yeah, Assassin and Scout were the two that were being voted as the actual, probably what you should start people on, right? Because even tracking, as niche of a thing it is, if you're a new player, it feels good to track someone out of Insubstantial every now and then. It's a very direct effect that only you can do that fast.
The majority of our new players play Barbarian.
Barbarian was also one that was kind of like Monk, because you had those immunities where you could just ignore stuff, but that doesn't teach you... Not only does it not teach you whatever you're immune to, but it doesn't even teach you enchantments, because you'll never get any.
Well, here's also the difference with that. Monk, from what I've seen, Barbarian still is realizing that, oh, I'm not affected by that gray ball or that white ball. And they still learned a few things, while Monk... I've seen a lot of new players start Monk, and then at 6th level... still not know anything because of that, which is terrible. But I mean, Monk is, it's also, it's very good against magic classes who don't know what they're doing, but if you're playing against good casters, Monk is hilarious. However, they really are actually strong versus magic. It's just, we don't let them know that.
We're creative in making sure that they don't realize it.
Yes, which is one I would have when people are like, oh, Monk's terrible. It's like, ha, you fools.
I'm dying for women to be alone.
Or Phase Bolt, but that's really our only answer, is do it in all honesty. So they're a great class for countering this. Yeah. I mean, again, though, Monk, I would never throw a new player into Monk because there's so many bad things. And just like we said for our last question, to let them know if they really want to play this game, for them learning about magic, Monk does the exact opposite. So, I mean, I'd only recommend it if a bell player wants to play Amgard.
And if you want to be gentle, the wizards can always, or the verbal casters can always just try to not go ham on the new players. Like, and that's how they'll learn. Yeah. Don't just walk up and, like, 8,000 spell combo them. I know Steel Life confuses the hell out of new players, because you just walk in and you, like, Steel Life, and they're just like, do I go home now? What just happened?
Yeah, so when they do that, I will still Ice Ball and Shatter them and Steal Life every now and then, but what I do when they're Ice Ball, I'm like, you're frozen for 60 seconds, so you can't do anything unless it starts you like this, and I Shatter them. I say, now you're dead, and Steal Life, and say, now what I did was I recharged my ability and I just cursed. So I explained to them everything that what happened, and then... Yeah, it's explained to it's a lot, but at the same time, I don't target them a lot. They're targeting new players will not get you better. It's just, I mean, sometimes I'll just Ice Ball and leave them, even if I have that potential to shatter, but it's, you don't want to just destroy someone who's coming. That's true.
I kind of view them as, like, pests most of the time, and I just kind of throw or shove them away from me and focus on the real targets.
Yeah. Question. Okay. This is coming from a bard.
Ooh.
Yep. He really wants his question to be asked. How do you guys deal with combat bards?
Okay. So first off, bard is like my second class, is almost as much as wizard for me that I love. So I have some extra insight for you on this. First off, combat bard is amazing 1v1. But when you add more people to it, it gets substantially weaker. Combat Bard versus 5 people, extremely weak. Combat Bard at events, extremely weak. Because you can't counter your songs versus other people. So the easiest way to deal with Combat Bard is to have, let's say, a barbarian come at them, and you come up with an uncharged spell, and it's an ice ball. They're either saying Song of Freedom or Song of Survival. You do something else, like, let's say, wound them or heat their weapon, and then they're screwed because they're going to die by the barbarian. Literally, just bring one other person, and combat bard's done. It's not too hard. If it's 1v1, then they're the strongest class, and you have to trick them to win, but really, it's just get more people, and combat bard gets weaker with the exponential amount of people.
You'll probably need to overwhelm a few Oz to get to that point, but yeah.
If they start to awe, break suppression. I mean, command. Break. Break concentration.
Do what just happened to you.
Yeah. Exactly.
Reinhardt, do you have any follow-ups on that?
I know. You... Jerk. He's my dedicated bard.
Does he play combat bard? Is he learning? Is he inquiring about the weaknesses to how to?
He does. Me and him have a little deal going where I'll give him persistent pro mag, and then anytime somebody comes up and tries to dispel him, I'll run in and ambulant break concentration on him.
All right. So next question, unless Reinhardt pops in with something else, do you guys have any bread and butter combos with or for specific classes? Like when you see a class standing across the field, do you go, this is what I have packed for them? Like, do you have a go-to? And what are they, and what classes do you use them against?
So the honest truth is that, and I can see it in your guys' faces, we don't want to limit ourselves to a bread-and-butter combo, because that, if you limit yourself, then you're going to think of that, you're going to use that a lot, you're going to run out of that, and unless you're hyper-focused, like, I'm a warlock, and I'm going to lightning bolt a barbarian, then yeah, sure, but bread and butter, I always try to mix it up so I'll never know what to expect.
Agreed.
Yeah. Keep them on their toes.
Yeah, and the strength of wizard is versatility. If you focus too much into one, then you're not focusing on your strength as a wizard.
You're not being a wizard, yeah.
Mm-hmm. Let me just check the email, because we are all out of questions. Stream chat, if you have any more questions or anything you'd like to say, you know what, while they're thinking of options, I'm going to bring this up, especially because Tenebrus isn't here to defend it. Wizzo, why don't you tell us your thoughts on Icy Blast?
Oh my god! Okay, so... Yes, now you over the Tenebrus. First of all, if you watch this, Tenebrus, I want to say screw you for bringing that up when I basically said I won't bring it up to start this. So, Icy Blast. First of all, screw Icy Blast. The reason why? You know when a noob comes out with a flail or a war pole and they're like, yeah, I'm so good because I did this. And if I try, then in 10 days I'll get the best I can in my life with a flail or a war pole. It's the same with Icy Blast. It's the newest version of casting. If you look at point system, it's not effective. You can do a whole bunch of other better ways of doing it instead of having two experienced things. Either you need to bar to confidence twice, or you need to actually spend a charge times 20 or two STLs, and you can do a lot better with like Ice Ball and then Shatter, or combining with your other teammates like a druid. And while, yes, you can have support, again, even as I stated in big games, it's not reliable because we are 1v1 fighters down to earth and down at heart. And I know you have a dedicated bard, Lexus, like you were saying for Reinhardt. None of us have that pretty much as a luxury. So Icy Blast Shatter is a terrible idea with that. While his main strength is sorcery and attracts a lot of people like flies, it is an answer to a situation. But if you're spending a third of your points with really minimal effect as to what you could utilize on your spell list, then if you're spending a third of your points to counter, like, let's say, one person primarily, because you're going to try to shut one person down, then it's only one for one, and you're not being better than everyone else. You're being better than one person, which, I mean, you should kill, like, 6, 7, 10 people and just keep them all down, because they're your peons. They're not even... You need to go onto the field and look at it and be like, why are you all here? You think you're people? And then just murder them, because they're not. You need to kill all of them equally. And if you're facing a Paragon, like a Paragon, there's just one Paragon Druid that, I mean, I haven't had as much practice, so every once in a while, like, we meet and he's annoying to me because it's just a bit of a pain. If I did Icy Blast Shatter, yeah, sure, I could kill him, but I'm not improving myself as a wizard. I'm not improving myself as a spellcaster. I'm instead limiting myself to being like, oh, I can kill you. But, I mean, I've nerfed myself horribly, which it's kind of the same as, like, if you're a druid and you take Avatar Nature Ranger, you're buffing yourself, but you've nerfed your potential overall.
Don't start an argument with the druids now. Because we'll have a class battle the next one. We'll have two wizards, two druids, and you guys can just fight for 2 hours.
I'm just saying,
it's important to note here that Wizo is not saying that Shatter is bad or freezing people is bad. He's specifically talking about Icy Blast. I think a lot of people hear Icy Blast is bad and think the whole idea of freezing and shattering people is bad. That is not what he's saying.
Icy Blast for Wizard because it's per refresh, which makes it a charge times 10. For Druid, per life, who cares? It's great. For Wizard, it is a piece of crap that keeps you being a noob. So, that is how I feel about it, and that's how everyone should feel about it, especially Tenebrus, since he's not here to defend himself.
Alright, we had a bunch of questions come in, so I'm going to ask the one that just popped up. What is your least favorite spell, and how would you justify taking it anyway?
Icy Blast.
Ravage. I hate that spell. I really do. It's so wordy.
I try to make it like my bread and butter spell, but it's really hard.
It's so wordy, though. Okay,
how would you justify taking it anyway? Not just shitpost it until it's...
So here's how I would justify taking Icy Blast. If I felt like I wanted to see what all the hype was around Icy Blast, and there was this healer that kept annoying me, and I had to extension Icy Blast and then get close, since no one else had release, out of 5 out of 9 class ever release, I know no one else has release, I have major metagame knowledge, I know that's somehow the only way, and basically what I'm saying is there's a snowball chance in hell that I'll ever take Icy Blast, because I should be able to overcome it with a lot better.
Alright.
Yeah, killing a healer.
Berrian, why would you take Ravage?
The only time I would take Ravage, and I have done this early on whenever I was playing, was it's crowd control, just knock somebody to the ground. That's about the only reason I would ever take, is just knock them to the ground real fast. Where I don't have to actually touch them, they just drop to their knees, or posting, as I do see a lot of people doing for some reason. I think going to your knees is better, but that's not the question here.
Well, one really awesome thing about Ravage, though, you get it off once, people are like, wait, what are you saying? They listen to it. You get it off once, and then it's an infinite free shove of, like, 10 feet.
I think the only reason why I would ever take the spell Ravage is if I really messed up and was playing Battle Mage Warlock.
Oh, come on, dude. Ravage is great. Like, I always take it on my Battle Mage list. It's actually changed the game.
If I do Battle Mage Warlock, I'll take it, but I don't play that very often at all.
Neither do I.
I don't play Battle Mage Warlock ever. It's not a good idea. But you should take it when you're Battle Mage. Like,
all right. Oh no! Actually, you know what? I think we were just onto something there. Why do you like Ravage's Battle Mage?
So, Ravage is a wordy spell, but I can do incants really fast, so let me do an example of Heat Weapon.
Oh.
I call Pumpkin, hit the sword, I call Pumpkin, hit the sword, I call Pumpkin, hit that sword. Okay. Now compare it to Ravage. Just for Ravage, that'll touch me, be fragile. Just for Ravage, that'll touch me, be fragile. Just for Ravage, that'll touch me, be fragile. It's not too much longer for me. I mean, it may have come off a little weird over the internet connection, but it's not too long for me. I can move while doing it, and if I can move while doing it, it can always be a threat. I won't die, so I'm always giving a state onto someone, and they know I'm setting up a wounding combo. Nice, I like it.
Oh, so he has to top us.
There we go. Bottle in the cap. I like it.
All right. Sorry for derailing that.
So I do want to make a correction. I screwed up and I mixed wounding and ravage in my head whenever I was explaining the description. So my bad.
That's
on
what
that
I was
one.
Confused about. Yeah.
Yeah. No, I screwed it up in my head because if I think ravage, I think wounding automatically because it's a combo kill. So, like, I flipped it in my head.
If you have anything, when you go back and look at your own lectures, if you notice something you said wrong, let me know. I can add annotations, so when people reading it, they'll get a little correct.
Pyrotechnics, armor. I don't play with people who have armor very often, so I just think, okay, blow up all your shit. I forget the armor doesn't count. I don't play with people who have armor often.
But also, if you do Battle Mage and you're in a kingdom where there's knights, and if someone's in AP, wounding Ravage is a great combo, especially if they have armor, because they're probably good. If you have noobs on your team, you need to shut them down. Ravage wounding is always a viable option. I mean, unless you're facing a paladin, but it's usually a viable option for you if you're battle mage, and you can get it off with enough practice. And it's another kit to add more versatility to you. I mean,
all right. Moving on, I got a couple more questions. This was meant more as a joke post, but I'm going to try to make this something relevant. How do you feel... So druids get naturalized magic, but we have a charged dispel. Do you think druids are still the better dispellers? Do you think that our chargeable dispel has an advantage? Talk. Druid dispel versus wizard dispel.
Whenever I'm in big games and people are looking for someone to dispel, they're looking for a wizard. I don't see people looking for a druid very often. They're looking for the wizard who's going to have the charge 3.
So here's the thing. It depends on longevity and the refreshes. If you're in a large game and there's druids and you have refreshes at 15 minutes, your dispel is worthless. Reason why? You dispel all their stuff. They will get it back by the time you pretty much finish the spell.
Yes.
If there is no refresh, and it's like a 30-minute game, and it's a large game, or whatever else, or even a small game, then your dispel is worth it. But overall, it depends on if the game designer screwed up and put refreshes at 15 minutes to make druids undispellable unless there's another druid, or if they made it actually have longevity to where you can actually have the time to dispel all their spells and still do other things as well. So I say it depends on the game, really, on the refreshes.
Okay. So Reinhardt had a follow up. So we talked
about another
counters to the combat bard. What if you're solo? What if he catches you off guard? What if he's hunting you and you just happen to be solo? Do you just like swift teleport? I'll find friends, or what if you need to fight him?
I would say, like, I've run into this situation with him before solo. Normally, what I try to do is, before he starts singing a song, suppress him. Instantly. Before he starts singing a song, suppress him, so he can't, that way I have the upper hand. If I can suppress him and he can't sing, that means he can't get his, song of interference up. Which means I can ambulant, and that gives me an extra 10 seconds to kill him that way. So now he's charging me, but now I can get away and kill him at the same time.
It depends what your spell list is as well. Like, if it's generalist, I might go with what you were saying if I'm just a generalist. If I'm battle mage, I might start with a hold, get him to sing Song of Freedom or Interference to burn it, and then I'd heat his weapon while running away. And after I heat his weapon, then I'd probably just stab him with a dagger to death really quick before he'd need a release up. But they're not going to think, I'll switch release on the weapon usually. So I might do that, but I might also do wounding because not very many bards take interference. I'm the only bard I know of. I guess now Reinhardt, which is awesome. But I guess we're the only two bards I know who actually take interference. So usually I probably do wounding, but that's again if I'm battle mage. If I'm a broker, then I mean...
Evoker, you just lob fireballs until he dies.
Yeah, exactly.
Like, until he fireball dies. And spear.
Yeah.
Yeah. As a warlock, it's really annoying, but maybe threaten and entangle, like pull out and entangle, have him switch songs to freedom, and then heat his weapon. do the same dagger stab, but overall, these are a lot of hypotheticals. It really depends on my spell list. It depends if I know him and I know what he has. It also depends upon if I think I can trick him, or if I should just run away to another teammate. Because as a wizard, that is always a viable option. Run away to another teammate. Run away to a meat shield, because their job is to take the hits, not you, since you're more important than that.
I'm going to tag right off of that in saying that a lot of Amp Guard right now, big, you know, giant games where the people next to you might just be faceless people that you've never met, or even in smaller games where you're on a team that's just, you know, randomly picked 1-2, 1-2, or haphazardly balanced, we're almost being trained to think of ourselves in a void, and not enough people work as a team. Teamwork is so strong. And if you have played any Phoenix League, you'll know how broken and how strong teamwork can get if you are on a team with people who are on the same level as you. You don't need to 1v1 people that you can't take. You fall back, you know, and teamwork is very strong, and never think that you have to 1v1 someone.
You're speaking along kind of what I reference your big battle games, where we're used to being fighters and not soldiers, where we don't fight with each other as well. But, I mean, along with that, since we're used to just 1v1ing, on a big battle game, you're not premeditating teamwork beforehand with everyone, and they're just nameless faces. So when you run by them, you may have to tap them and say, kill him, or run around them, so then they have to fight them. So you force the fight. Otherwise, I have ran around 30 people saying, kill him, or just ran without saying anything as someone chased me and they didn't do a damn thing, which was terrible. So
I've had that happen too.
Most of the time when I'm running away from somebody who's about to kill me and I'm trying to get back to teammates, I'll try to run through my team. That way somebody will notice him and somebody will hit him as I'm running away.
Unless they're enchanted or they're a good fighter, then they'll be like, oh god, he might hit me back or something, which is, it's annoying. Even when it happened one time where I did it with a druid, dispelled him so he didn't have any of his crap, ran through my team, and they didn't want to fight him because he was enchanted and stuff.
Alright. The last question that I see here, if you have more questions, please post them. We've got about, I don't know, 5 minutes left. Do you guys miss staffs? For anyone who is playing in V7, do you guys wish you could use staves?
I only played very, very, very tiny briefly, so I don't know.
Weapon staves, not.
That's so awesome.
Yeah, that is an awesome staff. But do you miss the ability to take a weapon staff or like a great weapon to use for that RP flavor that you can actually whack a person with?
Just give me a pole arm. That's all I want.
Yeah.
They're fun if you go in flurby, but they've never been practically useful, if that's what you're asking. Otherwise, I do miss that option of having a staff and being like, I'm a real wizard because I have a staff. And you're like, how much points did you spend on that? It may have made me not a real wizard, really, but it looks awesome. Isn't that what we're here for?
I traded all my elemental powers for this stick.
At that point, you're just like a bard pretending you're a wizard. It's great.
Yeah, so I'm gonna give about 10 seconds here. If you guys want to say some final thoughts while we get in any final questions, otherwise we're gonna wrap it up. Final thoughts, anybody?
Wizard of the best.
Yeah, play Elemental Barrage.
Okay, so here's the thing on archetypes. I would say that they're situational. Like, if you're playing a skirmishing game, I would say Battle Mage is better than Elemental Barrage because you're able to do a lot more movement and have a lot more constant effect on the game, because if you're throwing spell balls, you'll have to recover them. And if it's a skirmish, they're probably not throwing them back and you have downtime, so Battle Mage would be better on a skirmish, potentially. In per-life games, Warlocks do... I mean, in a game where it's kills matter, then Warlocks do have a higher potential. And I would say also that the one real problem with Evoker is dealing with enchants. Because even if they have, like, let's say, Ancestral Armor, Flameblade, Golem, you can phase them. You can sphere them, but they still have those enchants. And that's a problem. So, I mean, there are weaknesses to Evoker, which, I mean, I wish it was like weaknesses in this class aren't as strong as, I mean, weaknesses in this archetype aren't as bad as weaknesses for the other ones as well, but I would say that they all have a place. And Evoker is really good at punching a hole or having, I mean, it does the most burst damage in the game, especially if you have your kit memorized. Like, as you were saying, you like multiple stuff. Yeah. It is the most burst damage in the game. And that's if you also have your kit memorized. Because if you're just pulling from a bag, like, I have my bag. What am I? Fireball. Lightning Bolt. Entangle. Barbarian Charging Me. Oh, I pulled a Lightning Bolt. I mean, oh, I pulled an Ice Ball. Well, that Barbarian's got me. So I like that you actually stated that you have to actually have it a full kit memorized where you're putting your Evoker Balls. Otherwise, it's not as strong.
No, it doesn't become muscle memory at that point. It's leaving up to a crapshoot. That's what that... I'm dead.
That's why I wanted to put that specification in Evoker, not just for, like, archetypes or better things, but you need to have it memorized, because I've seen Evokers come out with, like, a giant bag, like, I'm playing Evoker, Evoker is awesome. It's like, you're just not being that effective.
Hey, okay. On the bag aspect, my bag actually has separate pockets inside of it that I know exactly where all of them are.
That's fine. So
it's
That's
one
fine.
Big bag, but of course it's separated like pouches.
I also That's have fine. My spell balls have different texture covers on them, so I can feel most of them just by the texture of the print on the balls.
That works. I like that.
Yeah, as long as you have a way to make it where it's not just, I'm pulling a crapshoot every time. Then yeah, Evoker does have its place.
Alright, we're talking about spell balls. We have a spell ball question came in. Any advice for improving spell ball aim/distance?
So, I've given so many trials, but I'll let you do it first, Lexus, since you're a Evoker.
Well, good thing that Wizo does is he has you put a shield up about 20 feet away, right, Wizo?
And it starts at 20, but it can go to 50.
Yeah, it goes to that. So 20 to 50, you throw your spell balls at the shield, try to get them out as fast as possible. Bakasura's at my park, so I've been watching him do that as well. But what I will say, I did talk to Bakasura about this the other day, yeah, that'll get your accuracy up, but at the same time, when you're in a battle game, nobody is going to be standing still for you to hit unless they're just totally oblivious that you're there. So you need to start working on leading your prey into where, throwing it where they're going to be instead of where they are. That is a big thing. I played quarterback in high school. You have to lead receivers. I lead my enemies just as I lead receivers. If you're running full speed that way, I know that you can't stop. So I'm going to throw it about 10 feet in front of you. By the time you reach and the ball intersect, it'll hit you. Sidearm is probably the best way to do that. Because your release point is not up here. So if you release it down here, the ball is going to go straight into the dirt. If you release it too high, it's going to sail. Sidearm's a good way to keep it parallel with your shoulder, and it'll have a smaller arc hitting its target. So that's what my thoughts are on the whole thing.
Yeah. Along with that, the shield exercise, also, it is meant to help you hit a standing target, which is the first part, but in all honesty, you'll get the leading a target, usually. Usually you'll get that if you're playing a wizard, but the problem is you get a thing called Master Wizard Syndrome, and I had this bad at one point, where you won't be able to hit someone standing still because you're always trying to hit where they're leading at, so a person, if they want to dodge, just stood still after a while when I was trying to throw spell balls, and that, I would say don't get Master Wizard Syndrome because people will take advantage of that, or Master Archer Syndrome is what it's also called. Where you only hit people if they're leading, or you always anticipate that. Because that'll come in time, and it is important to get that, as you said, Laxus, but that's the main thing. And also, again, lobbing, terrible. Another great thing with sidearm is usually I have the tail in between my fingers so that I'm able to just have it release, and not having the tails too long because that'll destroy the flight time as well. You want them to be a little bit short, too, so that it flies very nice. And if you throw sidearm as well, you're actually aiming for center of mass, which is where you're supposed to aim if you're trying to shoot someone normally, and you'll have a higher chance to hit.
Aim small, yeah, miss small, absolutely. Go ahead, sorry.
Well, I was disagreeing with you, like, especially when you're trying to hit that monk and they're trying to block it when you have a phase bolt. Yeah. Or a force bolt. Force bolt. Yeah. But you go, sorry about that.
Also, one more small thing. Practice throwing on the run, because there will be times where you will throw it on the run, and that can change your entire... I could throw it the same way on the run. It's going to miss because my body's in a different position than I would normally throw it. So you got to get used to throwing it on the run as well. And the closer you are to a target, the easier they are to hit. So run up, run and gun them. So get as close as you physically can outside of their threat range to hit them with the ball, because now it's a much bigger target to hit. Yeah. I just hope you know.
So on that, a question came up. Recommended spell ball build, like material-wise. How do you build your spell balls? Oh, here we go. Do you have a cross-section? Can we get like a nice steak knife and just...
So while he's gone, I'm gonna say my spell ball tech is not what I'd recommend for everyone, because it takes forever, and I'd rather build swords than spell balls. But explain Lexus yours really quick.
These are $2 at Walmart. They are a low compression core, high visibility felt gamma ball. They're
show,
a practice.
Show those nice ball. And close for us. Show those. Can you show the tag maybe? I don't know.
Yeah, sure.
There we go. Bam.
Okay.
They have a pretty good weight to them. They're exactly 2.5 inches. So they're perfect. And they're completely squishy. They're coreless. And they have a little bit of weight to them, so you can throw them farther, and they're pretty accurate.
Now, I have a question about those, actually, specifically, because someone at my park who also plays Wizard told me those are not viable because they have a rubber... Like, they have rubber on the inside of them. I didn't think that was true. I don't know.
No, absolutely not, because I know a guy that uses loose rubber bands for his spell balls.
See, I thought that was fine, but he was like, oh, it has to be all foam. I was like, no.
If you're in the academy, I believe there was a whole discussion on this with, like, charts and someone... Lauxus, was that you posting all the tennis ball comparisons? Someone posted, like, tennis ball grading to show which types of balls are legal and which ones are not, and those ones are, in fact, legit, so...
Yes, the low compression and the foam ones are. So,
I have the foam ones now.
But these are really good.
For
perfect bit.
So, for spell balls, though, what I do is I do a painful process, but they're the best spell balls I've ever gotten for distance and everything else, is I get a whole sheet of denim from, like, Joann's, wherever else. I cut it into little 1x1 squares. I make it all damp in a strainer, pad dry it a little bit, mop it up into a cloth, roll it as tight as I can, and then cover it with electrical tape and rubber band, mainly just rubber band. But I do electrical tape usually to start out to make sure it's still there. And then it's fine, but that process is hell by cutting little 1x1 squares and dampening it and doing it for each one. But what it does is that it makes the denim compress as well, so that it sticks together. It gives it a lot of weight, gives it also a lot of impact, to where if you make it big enough and do it well, actually, I wouldn't say hurt someone, but they noticed that the spell ball hit, and it felt like it had more impact than a sword. So the process of me doing it is long, but the reason why I state that is so that you can see there are other ways of doing spell balls. They don't have to be just foam or rubber bands or things like that. You can even make up your own, and it can be better or worse. So don't just be restricted to being like, it can't be gamma balls. Be like, why not? And actually critically analyze that.
I didn't see the post, so.
All right, so last question. That we have here. Someone came in at the tail end of Tenebrus' talk, but Tenebrus didn't really specifically cover this. Early lists for wizards, when you don't have access to those archetypes, what are some of the things that can help you make, you know, so you feel like you're not just grabbing whatever? What are some of those nice early lists that you can make?
Oh. As I said, I do a lot of first level points. Fourth bolts, amazing. 2 points for six of them right there. And as you say to Alexis, they are freaking amazing. Weapon destroying, like, that's already ridiculous. Right. But then you add armor breaking and wounding on top of it, like, they're better than throwies. They're amazing. And if you want, you can spend 4 points, 12 of them, and be like, well, I'm good now. Along with that key weapon, as we've kept seeing. What?
By 12 force bolts.
Sorry.
12 force bolts and a short sword. There you go.
Short sword.
Short sword and 12 force bolts.
I actually did that one. So, I recommend do not take experience, because if you don't have steel life, experience is a hard sell for things. It's a waste of points because it's too much. Unless you have, again, a dedicated bard, which, I mean, that's no. But force bolts are great. Shove is great, as we say, because it's chargeable. We've also stated that key weapon is amazing. I like banish over dimensional rift, personally, as well, because if you banish someone, they won't want to come near you because you're annoying. But if you kill them with dimensional rift, first of all, you're going to play a spell juke game. Second of all, they're going to want to try to one-up you. So banish just makes them go away, and they're like, I'm going to deal with you. Mend is always viable and always good for other people. Entangle also, 2 points. I mean, 1 ball for... Sorry, 1 point for 2 balls is a great investment. Great concentration, always great. Puts you up to par with other people. You can break concentration, force bolt that other caster and be like, I'm amazing, and I'm better than you, six-level wizard. Sometimes, you know, if I'm not that good of a wizard. But then you also... I mean, there's already a lot of options for you there. So... I mean, right there.
Were we just talking about first level or first and second?
The person just asked, let me see if I can scroll back up. I don't even know where this
low levels?
Just low level lists. So I'm probably like 1 and 2 is...
1 and 2.
Okay.
A good spell for wizard to have at low levels that can really mess with a 6-level healer is planar grounding. Mess with his gummies. The moment you plane or ground them in an existential state, it removes the gummy enchantment.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Take away his gummies from him. I mean, that's a good way for a level 2 wizard to be viable against a 6-level necromancer.
Mm-hmm.
Not a lot of people see that. Like, planar grounding is another great way to keep assassins from going into the shadows. It's really good. It's a really good spell, and I'm really sad that
I would personally say planar grounding is better against assassins because healers just have gummies charge times 3 versus your charge times 10. But against assassins, it's really great because it annoys them.
Oh, it's so much fun.
You could always just break concentration in assassin as well, and it serves usually the same effect as long as you follow up.
But I would also say don't underestimate the value of release. 5 out of 9 classes have it for a reason.
Release is good.
Yes.
Especially when you can release yourself from being stopped by druids.
Mm-hmm.
Yes.
All right. So that is the end. We're about 10 minutes over time, so I'm going to wrap this up. Guys, I'd like to thank you all for coming out. Wizo, Berrian, Lauxus, and Tenebrus. I know you're not here, but you'll hear us in the... when you watch this later. Everyone in live chat who contributed with questions, thank you guys for joining us for this whole thing. And if you want to see more of this, please share this, subscribe. We only need, like, I think 10 more subscribers till we can have a proper YouTube link. 10 more! So just subscribe. Once we see that we have the proper YouTube link, then you can just leave. I don't even care at that. Digital clap for all of our guests. Thank you very much. I think the Warriors are going to be coming on next, so we're going to do Paragon Academy Live Warrior, the like complete 180 from what we talked about today.
My favorite toys.
Yeah, so that's it. Thank you, everyone. And
and then they get really sad when I kill them.
So all right, keep it classy, everybody. Good night.
if you know the enemy and know yourself, you need not fear the result of 100 battles. If you know yourself, but not the enemy, for every victory gained, you will also suffer a defeat. If you know neither the enemy nor yourself, you will succumb in every battle.